Christmas special. This is the show for air 1224, recorded 1219. Take one.
How do you do, ladies and gentlemen? I'm Fahey Flynn. And on this Christmas Eve, we here at Channel 7 would like to invite you to a very special kind of Christmas party. Our personal holiday greetings to you and your family. In the next hour, we'll be visited by all the people who work here at WLS-TV. And we'll be musically entertained by the Viking Ensemble from Homewood-Flossmoor High School. So while you're wrapping those last few presents and waiting for Santa Claus to come, join us for some Christmas cheer and season's greetings from Channel 7. Ladies and gentlemen.
Mr. Flynn.
Yes?
Mr. Flynn, we don't mean to be barging in on your show like this, but we just wanted to make sure, some of us from Inc. wanted,
Susie!
Maybe you'd better tell him, huh?
Yeah. Mr. Flynn, Meister and Mike are worried that you're not going to...
Listen now, you know, there are people out there waiting. Is it that important?
This will only take a minute. You tell him, Susie. Go ahead.
Meister and Mike are worried that you're not going to include them in the Christmas show.
That's right.
Well, now, is that all? Of course you are. I mentioned before that all the people who work here at Channel 7 are going to be included on the show.
Well, in case you haven't noticed, Mr. Flynn, I happen to be a hamburger.
That's right, and I don't exactly look like John Drury either, you know what I mean?
Well, now, fellas, don't get upset, because everyone is going to have a chance, including the Ink cast, and John Coleman is watching his radar screen for the first signs of Santa Claus.
Do it, John.
Bob Kennedy and Susan Peterson will be here.
I know. I saw Joel Daly and John Drury and Iona and all those other guys out in the hall.
Oh, yeah. I was afraid for a while we was going to run out of makeup.
Well, why don't you all stay around for a little while? Because I was just about to read The Night Before Christmas with the help of some of the other program hosts here at Channel 7.
The Night Before Christmas. Don't you mean A Visit from St. Nicholas by Clement Moore?
How'd you know that?
You didn't know I was so pedantic, did you?
I don't even know what pedantic means.
Well, pedantic means you know what I mean. It's kind of a, you know, school teacher type, you know what I mean.
'Twas the night before Christmas, when all through the house, not a creature was stirring, not even a mouse. The stockings were hung by the chimney with care, in hopes that St. Nicholas soon would be there.
The children were nestled all snug in their beds while visions of sugar plums danced through their heads. And Ma in her kerchief and I in my cap had just settled our brains for a long winter's nap.
When out on the lawn there rose such a clatter, I sprang from my bed to see what was the matter. Away to the window I flew like a flash, tore open the shutters and threw up the sash.
The moon on the breast of the new fallen snow gave a luster of midday to objects below, when what to my wondering eyes should appear but a miniature sleigh and 8 tiny reindeer.
With a little old driver so lively and quick, I knew in a moment it must be St. Nick. More rapid than eagles his coursers they came, and he whistled and shouted and called them by name. Now Dasher, now Dancer, now Prancer and Vixen, on Comet and Cupid, on Donder and Blitzen. To the top of the porch, to the top of the wall, now dash away, dash away, dash away all.
As dry leaves that before the wild hurricane fly, when they meet with an obstacle, mount to the sky, so up to the house top the coursers they flew, with a sleigh full of toys, and St. Nicholas too. And then in a twinkling I heard on the roof the prancing and pawing of each little hoof. As I drew in my head and was turning around, down the chimney St. Nicholas came with a bound.
He was dressed all in fur from his head to his foot, and his clothes were all tarnished with ashes and soot. A bundle of toys he had flung on his back, and he looked like a peddler just opening his pack. His eyes, how they twinkled, his dimples, how merry. His cheeks were like roses, his nose like a cherry. His droll little mouth was drawn up like a bow, and the beard on his chin was as white as the snow.
The stump of a pipe he held tight in his teeth, and the smoke had encircled his head like a wreath. He had a broad face and a round little belly that shook when he laughed like a bowl full of jelly. He was a chubby old plump and a right jolly old elf, and I laughed when I saw him in spite of myself.
A wink of his eye and a twist of his head soon gave me to know I had nothing to dread.
And laying his finger aside of his nose and giving a nod, up the chimney he rose. He sprang to his sleigh, to his team gave a whistle, and away they all flew like the down of a thistle. But I heard him exclaim, ere he drove out of sight, "Happy Christmas to all, and to all a good night."
Say, you know, that was kind of nice, Susan. Kind of a corporate night before Christmas. Mm-hmm. I don't think there could be a more appropriate time than on Christmas Eve.
That's right. You know, Bob, it's also appropriate to go around on the night before Christmas singing from house to house, singing mm-hmm. Christmas carols. It may be a little bit difficult for us to get around to all the houses out there in the big city by tomorrow morning.
Yeah, particularly if you wait until right about now to start, Susan.
So we did decided to invite the Homewood-Flossmoor Choir to sing for you instead.
So here they are, a group of very talented young Chicagoans, the Viking Ensemble, from Homewood-Flossmoor High School.
Caroling merrily now we go, Christmas bells are ringing. Caroling, caroling through the snow, Christmas bells are ringing. Joyous voices, sweet and clear, sing those glad of heart to cheer. Ding, dong, ding, dong, Christmas bells are ringing.
That was just great, and we'll be hearing more from them a little later. By the way, here's where the cast from Interesting News for Kids comes in.
Oh,
Meisterberger?
You're on, Meister.
It's all yours.
Okay.
Here goes. Go, Meister, go.
Listen. Fröhlich Weihnachten und ein glücklich neues Jahr. How'd I do?
You know that in English?
Yeah.
Come on, Meister. Come on.
Fahey?
They're through.
We'll all be back with more in just a moment. Susie, Microphone, and Meisterberger are trying to figure out some other ways to say Merry Christmas in foreign languages. How's it going?
Not very well. We're trying to say Merry Christmas and Happy New Year in Italian.
Yeah, would you settle for the tire iron of my uncle is on the bureau of my stepfather?
Oh.
No?
No, but keep working on it while I get our prize movie hostess I own on the phone.
All right, okay. Oh, here's a good one. How about a translation of the fork is in your garage?
No.
That's
terrible.
I'm sorry. No.
Thank you, Fahey, and here's a little kiss for you too, big fella. This is a very special night, and I have a very special guest right here on the phone, and we're talking to, all the way from the North Pole, Santa Claus.
Hello.
Hello, Santa Claus.
Yes, this is Santa Claus. Who's this?
This is Io from the Prize Movie here in Chicago.
Oh, yes. Love your show, Io. And I think the song is We Wish You a Merry Christmas.
Well, that happens to be right, Santa. But you see, I'm not doing the prize moving right now.
This is a bad connection, Ione. Is it Deck the Halls?
Well, you were right the first time, Santa. But you don't understand. I'm not giving away any prizes right now.
Oh, that's too bad. I was hoping I could win a radar range or something like that.
Well, no, I really called because I understand you're just about to leave on your annual trip around the world.
Right on, Ione. Yeah. As a matter of fact, you caught me at a rather bad time.
Oh.
Actually, I was just hitching the reindeer up when you called.
Well, Santa, in that case, I won't keep you any longer. We'll be waiting for you here in the Windy City.
Well, it ain't exactly come up here, Ione. By the way, tell John Coleman not to try any of his goofy tricks this year. I told him before it's not necessary to light a flare on his roof. I'll find his house.
Oh, well, I sure will, Santa.
Yeah, tell him to leave a bottle of Christmas cheer if he wants to do something for me.
Oh, well, okay, Santa. Well, bye. I'll see you real soon.
Bye, Ione. Oh, Merry Christmas, everybody.
Yeah, to you too. And to all of you, a Merry Christmas and a very Happy New Year.
Thank you, Ione. We're going to be visited by more of the Channel 7 staff, but right now I see that John Coleman is about to give us our first report of the evening concerning Santa's arrival. John?
Thank you very much, Fahey. Oh, and by the way, Santa Claus, if you're still listening, will Ripple Wine be all right? Anyway, folks, this is the big night, isn't it? Christmas Eve, when all we children in the world wait for the arrival of that great big old fat man with his bag of tricks. That doesn't necessarily mean your uncle from Duluth. No, folks, I mean good old S. Claus, and on the radar screen sometime before this program is off the air, I hope that we're going to get a radar picture of Santa's whereabouts. I haven't shown up yet. He comes down to us from the North Pole, you know, and he leaves about this time of night, and he brings all kinds of toys for the good little boys and girls. And for Frankie, he leaves a great big sack full of bituminous coal. Anyway, it's about up here that we should begin to see that radar blip. It should appear any time, but so far, Fahey, Santa hadn't shown up. Hadn't been sighted by anybody, but I'm going to keep a very sharp lookout. And so for the moment, it's back to you.
Stand by, John. We'll be checking back with you in just a few minutes. John Drury is here now to tell us about a very memorable piece of journalism. And John, thanks for taking some time out of your Christmas Eve.
Thank you, Fahey. On this night before Christmas, I'd like to take a couple of moments to read a now-famous letter to the editor of the New York Sun from Virginia O'Hanlon, and its equally famous reply from Frank Church. Dear editor, I am 8 years old. Some of my little friends say there is no Santa Claus. Papa says, if you see it in the sun, it's so. Please tell me the truth. Is there a Santa Claus? Signed, Virginia O'Hanlon. And here is how Frank Church replied. Virginia, your little friends are wrong. They have been affected by the skepticism of a skeptical age. Yes, Virginia, there is a Santa Claus. He exists as certainly as love and generosity and devotion exist. Alas, how dreary would the world be if there were no Santa Claus. There would be no childlike faith then, no poetry, no romance to make tolerable this existence. We should have no enjoyment except in sense and sight. The eternal light with which childhood fills the world would be extinguished. Not believe in Santa Claus? You might as well not believe in fairies. You might get your papa to hire a man to watch in all the chimneys on Christmas Eve to catch Santa Claus. But even if they didn't see Santa Claus coming down, what would that prove? Nobody sees Santa Claus, but that's no sign that there is no Santa Claus. The most real things in the world are those that neither children nor men can see. Ah, Virginia, in all the world, there is nothing else real and abiding. No Santa Claus? Thank God he lives, and he lives forever. 1,000 years from now, Virginia, no, 10,000 years from now, he will continue to make glad the hearts of childhood. Those words from Frank Church to Virginia O'Hanlon. And may I add my own wishes for peace on earth and goodwill toward men at Christmas time. I'm John Drury.
Ladies and gentlemen, Meisterburger has something else to tell you.
Yeah, thank you, Susie. Wer solchek schwat od zega narodzenia.
Hey, that was very nice, Meister.
Thank you very
much. Mike, you were no help at all.
Are you kidding? I'm still trying to figure out how to use the glossary.
It was very good.
Welcome back to our Channel 7 Christmas party. And here with more fine music from the Homewood-Flossmoor group are Bob Kennedy and Susan Peterson.
Thank you, Faye. You know, Christmas is a very special time of year for many reasons. And for just about everyone, it has a personal significance. It might be just a memory of a Christmas past, where you were, or what you were doing at an important time in your life. Or it might be a time to give new thanks for one of the many good things in your life.
You know, Susan, it's interesting. I was thinking, as we're getting ready to do the show on Christmas Eve, about Christmas, and about what is it about Christmas that always makes it seem new and fresh and exciting. You know, we come down to it, the songs are the same, yet each year, White Christmas and Jingle Bells and Deck the Halls and Silent Night all seem to have their special meaning again. And they never seem to bore. Now, for instance, how many times have you put the same old top on the same old Christmas tree? And the tree itself now is probably a carbon copy of the one that stood in the same corner of the same room for the last, well, how many Christmases have you lived there now? Yes, each time you bring out the top, it causes the same oohs and ahs that it has for many Christmases past. And what about the thrill of a child seeing Santa and watching him make Chris privy to his dearest Christmas thoughts? Now, how many Santas has he seen in his young life? And yet, despite the duplication on street corners and on television and in ads, there's no confusion in this youngster's mind when he whispers into his own special Santa's ear. Somehow, they're all one. And from the best dressed in the most expensive department stores to the most bedraggled on a busy street corner, they're all Santa. And they're all part of the blessed sameness that we never tire of at Christmas. And what about your dinner? It'll be just about the same as the one last year, I'll bet, and probably the one the year before that. And yet somehow it will be as if you've just discovered the delight of a bird called turkey for the very first time this Christmas. And how about the stories? The after-dinner stories? How many times has Aunt Margaret told the one about the time that she and Uncle James had 3 flat tires back in the spring of 43, and they had to ride back into town in a farmer's wagon? Well, I guess every Christmas since 1943. And yet on Christmas you laugh again, and somehow it all seems new. Well, I guess that's part of the miracle of Christmas. No matter how many times you go through it, it always seems like it's happening for the very first time. And so when this Christmas is past and you begin to take down the same top from the same tree, and you wrap up that little ornament for its long winter's nap, it's going to be pleasant to think that it will all happen again, in much the same way again, a year from now. And yet, it will seem bright and fresh and new. It's a miracle that happens every year. And thank the Lord, we never tire of it. Now, here's the Viking Ensemble once again, and for you,
A Christmas Waltz.
That's the Viking Ensemble from Homewood-Flossmoor. For those of you who are trying right now to assemble one of those toys that are supposedly easy enough for an 8-year-old to put together, here are Bill Frink and Dwayne Dow from the Eyewitness News team, who are both considerably over 8 years old, but might still be able to offer some help.
Well, thank you, Fahey, very much. Yes, that's right, toy fans. Now, I know that you got a lot of things from Santa Claus tonight, and you probably got a lot of toys unassembled. But I want to tell you one thing, that if you don't lose your cool, stay calm, don't lose your cool, you can put them together. Right, Dwayne?
Yeah, Bill, and this one is something that really has me kind of turned on. It's called a talking super foon man.
Is that right?
A talking super foon man. And from what the instructions say, all you have to do is pull the string, and it comes up with 11 different phrases, and it kind of reminds me of John Coleman.
Hey, don't start saying things like that. We're going to have to put that commentary super up alongside of you. That looked bad.
Well, really, you probably wonder, well, how I could put this together.
Is that for a boy or a girl?
I don't know. But anyway, I put it together very easily. What I did was just look at the simple, detailed instructions that came along with it.
Mm-hmm.
And you don't have to be a master mechanic to do it. And really, the instructions were very easy. It just said put slot B into slot C, and slot E into F, and G into H, and K into L. And Bill, there it is. And so I think, I hope anyway, that it proved that if you've got the patience and the desire to get the job done right, you can put these things together on Christmas Day.
I must congratulate you. Well, Dwayne, you've proved one thing. You've proved that man can win over machine. And Fahey, I want to wish on behalf of myself and Dwayne Dow, everybody a Merry Christmas.
Well, fellas, as they say in sports, there's always next year. But while you're trying to put that thing back together, here's John Coleman with what I hope is an update on the radar watch for Santa Claus.
Well, we're still here standing by our special Channel 7 radar hookup, looking for the first signs of Santa's approach from the North Pole, but nothing yet. I was just on the telephone, though, with the Strategic Air Command headquarters out at Omaha, and they reported that at approximately 11:15 p.m. Eastern Time, an unidentified flying object, one large radar bleep, led by eight smaller little bleeps, was picked up over what is known as the North Pole in the Arctic Circle, just out of our radar range, darn it. Well, whether or not that was Santa Claus is unknown at this time, but indications are that it was. And folks, that would mean that Santa has started his annual trip to the homes of boys and girls all over the world. And Sack told me that they're sending out a squadron of jets, not only to identify positively what that craft was, but also to act as an escort when Santa enters the territorial boundaries of the United States. So we here at Channel 7 are standing by. Just a while ago, we had quite a start. What we thought might have been Santa in the Chicago area turned out to simply be one big old mallard duck flying past Marina City, southbound. Keep going, Ducky. But at any rate, we are keeping our watch out for Santa, and we expect to have more to report later on. But as for now, that's it. So back to you.
Okay, John, we'll keep waiting. You know, Susan, I was just thinking, there are probably lots of kids out there tonight who are having a tough time getting to sleep.
Mm-hmm.
And if either of my two daughters, Liz and Susie, are still up and watching, you better get to bed. Remember, Santa doesn't come until you're asleep, kids.
Mm-hmm. And while you're waiting, Liz and Susie, we're going to have some great music. Here's the Homewood-Flossmoor Choir singing Happy Christmas Polka.
I'm just want to say buon Natale and buon Capodanno.
Well, what do you think?
Big deal. You get one right and you want to open up a pizzeria.
Oh.
Hey,
we'll be back for more in just a minute. Don't go away.
Nice.
Thank you.
it's my pleasure now to introduce my friend and colleague, Joel Daly, to present a Christmas Eve commentary. Joel?
Thank you, Fahey, and Merry Christmas to you. Ho, 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 humbug, he thought to himself as he watched the crush of shoppers. How incredibly commercial Christmas has become. Peace on earth now has come to mean a piece of the action. And here I am with my padded stomach and flame-resistant beard, taking orders for every toy advertised on television. Santa Claus? A little girl tapped on his arm. Santa, are you coming to our house on Christmas Eve? Why, of course, sweetheart, he answered automatically. Now tell me, what do you want for Christmas? Santa, can you bring my daddy a job? He's looked everywhere, and he gets so sad. Well, that's a little out of my line. Isn't there anything else? Santa, would you bring my mother a pretty robe? I think a pretty robe would make her feel better. He looked gently into those little eyes. Tell me, what can Santa bring you? In a voice that was barely a whisper, she replied, will you bring me a friend? Someone to play with? My mother's afraid to let me go out of the apartment alone. Well, now, I'm not sure I can do all of those things, he stammered. But Santa, she insisted, I believe in you. That's what makes Christmas so wonderful. He raised his moistured eyes and glanced again at the crowded store and smiled. Yes, that's what makes Christmas so wonderful. I'm Joel Daly.
Thank you, Joel. On this Christmas Eve, it's certainly appropriate to express and celebrate the religious meaning of this holiest of Christian holidays. But for all the families who are gathered together tonight, and more importantly for those who are not, it's also fitting to observe the spirit of Christmas as it has been timelessly expressed by Charles Dickens. Numerous indeed are the hearts to which Christmas brings a brief season of happiness and enjoyment. How many families whose members have been dispersed and scattered far and wide in the restless struggles of life are then reunited and meet once again in that delightful state of companionship and mutual goodwill. Is it so incompatible with the cares and sorrows of the world that the religious beliefs of the most civilized nations and the rude traditions of the roughest savages alike number Christmas among the first joys of life? How many old recollections and how many dormant sympathies does Christmas time awaken? We write these words now, many miles distant from the spot at which year after year we met on that day. A merry and joyous circle. Many of the hearts that throbbed so gaily then have ceased to beat. Many of the looks that shone so brightly then have ceased to glow. The hands we grasped have grown cold. The eyes we sought have hidden their luster in the grave. And yet, the old house, the room, the merry voices and smiling faces, the jest, the laugh, the most minute and trivial circumstance connected with those happy meetings crowd upon our mind as if the last assemblage had been but yesterday. It is indeed a merry, merry Christmas that can win us back to the delusions of our childish days, that can recall to the old man the pleasures of his youth, and transport the sailor and the traveler thousands of miles away back to his own fireside and his quiet home. In response to many letters from our viewers, we'd like to repeat a very unusual Action 7 Christmas story with Frank Matthey.
Seeing as this is a special evening at Action 7, we decided to do something special. So we prepared our own little Christmas story. It's called The News Hawk Who Saved Christmas. This is the city, Chicago, Illinois. It's December 24th, the day before Christmas. My name's Matthew. I'm a reporter. I was working the Action 7 shift out of Channel 7 News. Once again, our mail didn't take a holiday. Over 200 letters arrived.
Thank you. Oh, wonderful, wonderful.
Over 200 letters, but one stood out. It was from Mr. Claus. He was in trouble.
Oh, I just can't figure it out. I just don't know why anybody would want to steal it, especially on Christmas Eve.
Steal what, Mr. Claus?
Steal what? Why, my Santa Claus suit. You know, every year I give the shirt off my back so all these children can be happy, and then someone does this to me.
Just the facts, Mr. Claus. What did the suit look like?
What it looked like? Well, it was red with a white trim, and it had a red hat. Oh, and I had those new knee-length boots with the wet look.
What happens if you don't get the suit back, Mr. Claus?
What happens? I don't get it back. If I don't get it back by evening, then for millions of children all over the world, there'd be no Christmas.
11:37 a.m., just a little over 5 hours before Christmas Eve. In my experience, I've only met one man capable of stealing a fat old man's suit. Fat Freddy.
Yeah, what do you want?
My name's Matthew. I'm a reporter.
I'm Fat Freddy. I'm a thief.
Did you take Claus's suit?
You mean the red one with the white fur trim and the wet look boots?
Right.
Nah, I didn't take them.
Who do you think did?
How do I know? I steal clothes. I don't hate kids.
How's that again?
Well, I mean, anybody who'd steal Claus's clothes on Christmas Eve would have to hate kids.
Less than 3 hours till Christmas Eve. Fat Freddy was right. The only person who could steal the old man's suit is someone who hates kids and Christmas Eve. Someone like terrible Tommy Creep.
Yeah?
You Creep?
Yeah, I'm Creep. What's it to you?
My name's Matthew. I'm a reporter. I'm trying to find Claus's suit.
I didn't take Claus's suit. Why don't you try Claus?
Just the facts, Creep. Did you take it?
No. He ain't my size. Besides, I don't want Santa Claus to be home on Christmas Eve. I want him out giving coal to bad little kids.
How's that again?
Maybe somebody wants Santa Claus to stay home tonight.
Less than an hour before Christmas Eve. Time's running out for millions of kids all over the world. If Creep was right, there's only one person who could have the old man's suit. Only one person who'd want Santa home tonight.
Well, Sonny, I just had to do something. You see, for hundreds of years, I've been the loneliest woman in the world on Christmas Eve.
What about all those little kids, Mrs. Claus? What about them?
I just wanted one Christmas Eve with him. Just one. Is that so bad?
No, that's not so bad. Not if you give your husband his suit back now, right?
Right as rain, dear. He was just getting to be so much like Bob Hope. I just had to do something.
Well, I guess you're kind of happy getting your suit back. Well, we'll see and have a nice evening. One more thing, Mr. Claus.
Yeah, what was that?
Merry Christmas.
Well, Merry Christmas to you, too. Oh, by the way, Merry Christmas to you.
On December 24th, Mrs. Santa Claus was found guilty of loving her husband. And that's not a bad charge, especially on Christmas Eve.
Susie, you take this one.
Yeah, Suze, here's the card. You read that one in Spanish, okay?
All right. Feliz Navidad y un prospero año nuevo.
And a chicken taco.
Mr. Flynn will be back in just a moment. Charles, it's nice of you to come over and join us.
It's nice to be remembered on this Christmas holiday. And I wanted to stop in and add my own Christmas greeting to you and, of course, everyone out there. But I had another reason to drop in.
Why's that, Charles? Why's that?
Well, Bob, I got the word. I don't want to bring this up to any great length, of course. But I got the word that you were planning to join in the Viking chorus to sing on their next number.
I must say, I had given a little thought. Yeah.
Well, may I be the second person to discourage it?
Well, second? Who's the first?
The director of the Viking Choir,
oh.
Walter Rodby. He's worked a hard, long hours on this thing, and I hate to see a grown man cry.
All right.
Sorry.
All my practicing. In the key of K.
Well, if that's the way they want it, here's the Viking chorus, a cappella. In other words, without me.
Praise his name.
That once again was the Homewood-Flossmoor Choir. And I see, ladies and gentlemen, that John Coleman has an urgent report that he'd like to bring us. John?
Ladies and gentlemen, I was just on the phone again with the Strategic Air Command in Omaha, and they report that one of those jet planes that was sent up, you know, in the area up around the Arctic Circle, did confirm that that UFO was indeed S-Claus, but he's now headed down over Canada toward the Chicagoland area. The jet squadron is accompanying Santa Claus through the radar boundaries into the territorial Oh, here's a bulletin just in. Hey, this is great news, folks. Word's just been received. Santa is not only now in the United States, but he's approaching the greater Chicago area. So, there he is on the radar right now. Yes, sir, folks, as you can see, the radar blip definitely is old Santa Claus. And here he comes in towards Chicago. So, Fahey, the magic time's arrived. It is truly time for peace on earth and goodwill toward men. It's Christmas!
It is indeed, John. And from all the staff and management of WLS-TV, I'm Fahey Flynn, wishing you all a very Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year.
We wish you a Merry Christmas, we wish you a Merry Christmas, we wish you a Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year. Good tidings to you, wherever you are. Good tidings for Christmas and a Happy New Year. We wish you a Merry Christmas, we wish you a Merry Christmas, we wish you a Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year.
Merry Christmas and good night.